My name's Nick Abbey, and I have the considerable pleasure of being the chief executive of an organisation called the ExtraCare Charitable Trust. The clue is in the title of the organisation. We are a not-for-profit organisation, we're a charity, and we develop retirement housing with care. We have been doing that since about 1988. The organisation is based in Coventry, and we tend to operate around what we call the Greater Midlands. So originally the developments were around Coventry, Northampton, Stoke, and we now stretch as far as Warrington and St Helens, Sheffield in the north, and Hereford in the southwest, and Gloucester, and over towards Milton Keynes and Northampton in the southeast, and everywhere in between. That's the area we operate. I want to pick up in this session some of the themes that I thought Phil Hope expanded very, very well in the last session. And aside from the generous trailer that he gave for ExtraCare housing in particular, I think there were all sorts of themes that that he touched on, which will become apparent as we go through this. And I'm going to do it, first of all, by showing you a film for 6 or 7 minutes that was made for us last year, which should give you a pretty good introduction to what life is like in one of the ExtraCare retirement village settings. And then I've got some slides after that, and hopefully there'll be some time for some Q&A thereafter. So without more ado, hopefully everybody will be able to hear it, but I'm sure our friends at the back can adjust the volume if necessary.
We may be living longer in the UK, but we're not always living better. The ExtraCare Charitable Trust is a charity that wants to prove that this doesn't always have to be the case. ExtraCare operates over 13 villages and 17 smaller housing developments, providing homes for over 4,000 older people across the Midlands and the North. This is a typical ExtraCare village. It provides homes for between 150 and over 400 local people, who range in age from 55 to over 100. And it provides social, leisure and community facilities for many more, including friends, family and neighbours. You can buy a home here, share ownership with the charity, or rent. But the principle is that life here is within reach of everyone, even those who rely on a basic state pension. It's based on an ethos which says, later life is a time for broadening your horizons, not limiting them. The focus here is about encouraging independence, and the lifestyle on offer is all about staying active in body and mind for as long as possible. At an ExtraCare village, everyone has their own home, which will be a spacious one or two bedroom apartment incorporating all the latest safety and security features. There's a library and IT suite where residents can simply read the papers or learn computing, email friends and family, or surf the net. There are also craft and hobby rooms to make pottery, paint, draw, or learn a new skill. There's a woodwork studio with all the latest equipment. If residents don't fancy cooking a meal or just prefer a bit of company, there's a cafe, bar, and restaurant offering light meals and snacks. There's also a village hall which provides a central venue for all sorts of different activities and events, from dance classes to concerts and shows. And as village life is all about being active and staying healthy, it goes without saying there's a fully equipped health and fitness suite with state-of-the-art equipment and a fitness instructor available to guide and advise you. And if any resident is assessed as needing care and support, now or in the future, it can be provided, not in a care home or a care wing across the way, but in the comfort and privacy of your own home by a member of the ExtraCare team.
Cathy was in a care home for 18 months, and I questioned the quality of the care that she was getting because she wasn't being cared for, as I thought. But so I decided to get her out, and then I found out through someone else that these places were available, and within 3 months we got one. And it's wonderful. It's given us a new lease of life, this place.
ExtraCare's wellbeing programme is in all the smaller schemes and the villages, and it's the first of its kind in the UK. It's an example of how, with the right information and support, older people can make tangible improvements to their health. Led by dedicated wellbeing advisors, all qualified nurses, ExtraCare's wellbeing programme provides residents, as well as older people in the local community, with easy and approachable access to regular health screening, referring them to GPs and other specialists where appropriate. Assessments consider all aspects of physical and mental health, as well as lifestyle and fitness, diet and health and safety around the home. As the population ages, we're going to see a rise in the number of people developing dementia. ExtraCare has been working with experts from Bradford University to develop a new approach to supporting residents who develop dementia, and the Enriched Opportunities Programme is the result. The programme is based on dedicated team members in every ExtraCare scheme and village called locksmiths, working one-to-one with residents to unlock the positive memories and associations that aid their understanding and enjoyment of the present. Research has shown that as a result of the programme, people are less likely to feel depressed and rate their quality of life as significantly better. ExtraCare has been refining its village concept for many years and is seen by many as leading the field in the UK. It's certainly developing new ways of helping people live well in later life, and new alternatives to traditional care homes for those who need support as they age.
Independent living. That strapline was important because we didn't want to feel we were going in somewhere. You know, we're not going into anywhere. We're moving home. We're joining a community.
It's clear that communities like these are having a profound effect on people's quality of life. All the evidence suggests that they're helping people to stay active and independent for longer. That's obviously good news for the residents, but if people need less social care and medical intervention, it's also good news for the organisations that fund housing, healthcare and social services. And who knows, if ExtraCare can prove that a decline into ill health, isolation and frailty isn't an inevitable symptom of getting older, well, that's got to be good news for us all.
Is that nice? Dr. Mark Porter comes over very well. I want on a few slides now to pick out some of the themes that you've heard and seen in that film, and which go back to some of the things that Phil was talking about earlier on. Firstly, we have a very clear vision. It's simply better lives for older people. And we're about giving older people an independent, safe and secure future in that network of inspirational communities. And I think, you know, they genuinely are inspirational. And not my words, but when people come along and they visit an ExtraCare retirement village, they generally will come in and the first thing they'll say is, gosh, it's noisy, isn't it? There's a lot going on. There's a big buzz here. It's not one of the places that looks really smart, but is deathly quiet. There is a lot of activity, and that's really important to us, that it is a buzzy, vibrant place. And then people will say, but it feels like a country club, feels like a hotel, feels like a cruise liner, which is a bit scary, it could be, unless you happen to like that lifestyle. What they're saying is that they recognise that it's somewhere where you go and you engage and you are active, and there's a lot going on. So it's housing with care in villages, which is what we do now. We don't develop the smaller schemes, but we still have 17, which are around about 40, 50, 60 apartments each. But now we develop villages, and typically they're about 250 to 300 apartments in size. Big, very, very big. And as you'll have hopefully picked up from the film, these are for anyone. So we sell apartments to people. We sell proportions of apartments to people who might buy one on shared ownership. And we have a large number, always at least 20%, and often considerably more, which are available for people to rent. And when I say rent, I mean paying the same level of rent you'd pay if you were in local authority housing or housing provided by any other housing association, Anchor, Housing 21, Hanover, etc., etc., etc. So there isn't anybody, I'm going to put hand on heart now, there isn't anybody who would say they can't live there because they can't afford it. They can, and we make sure that they can. And in total, we've got about 3,500 apartments across the Midlands and the North, and we employ about 1,500 staff. And we have about 2,000 people who volunteer to work in these developments, either because they live there or because they live nearby. We also have a network of 63 charity shops, which again runs principally on the work done by volunteers, and which contributes around about £750,000 to our bottom line every year. Now, I don't know if anybody in the room has ever been to an ExtraCare Charitable Trust retirement village. Oh, congratulations. Which one? Yeah, Lovett Fields. Yeah? Yeah? Good. So that's one out of the room. But a number of you may have heard of ExtraCare housing, not just because Phil Hope mentioned it earlier. So ExtraCare is a generic term which describes a type of housing. And on this slide, I've put it on the left-hand side, and I'm calling it conventional ExtraCare. Because my guess is if you have a development near you which is called an ExtraCare housing scheme, it's probably mostly for rent with a bit of shared ownership, perhaps. It's probably 40 or 60 homes. Almost certainly, everybody that lives there gets some sort of care. And the only differential in that is whether you get low, medium or high levels of care. And that's largely because extra care housing in many, many places has been provided by local authorities as an alternative, and I think a good alternative, to residential care. And it's almost certainly been provided with grant from the government, a capital grant towards building it. Now, some of you who read the Saturday and the Sunday papers will have seen advertisements in there for a model of housing that sounds rather like this, which is probably in Berkshire or Surrey or Sussex, and it may be a number of bungalows or apartments built around an old stately home and run by my good friends at Audley Court or Retirement Villages or Richmond Partnerships or Life Care Residences or something like that. They would never, ever, ever call themselves an extra care housing development. They would call it retirement housing, retirement villages or whatever else. Extra care is a public sector term. But actually, they are providing exactly the same thing for a market that can afford to pay about £350,000 upwards. But it's all really the same sort of housing. The differentiating factors about what you've just seen compared with what's known as traditional extra care housing or conventional is that we've got this mix of tenure. So sales is a really important part of what we do. Shared ownership to bring sale within reach of even more people is a really important part of what we do. And the ratio will vary, and I'll show you a couple of examples of that later on. Typically now we're developing at about 250 homes. These are big. These occupy, you know, 6 or 7 acres, or the one that we're going to build start in Coventry starting later this year will go up to 10 stories high, which is 4 stories higher than anything that we've ever done before. But we're a long way from the biggest in the world, which I think is 54 stories in Chicago. So we have a little way to go yet. And we'd need a fairly sympathetic planning authority to allow something like that, I suspect. What we're selling is a lifestyle. And when people come to live in one of these retirement villages, it's not so much the 1 or the 2 bedroom apartment they're looking at, although that's clearly important to them. It's what they can engage in while they're there with some of the facilities that you've seen on the film. And only a minority of people that live in these villages will get care. Maybe a quarter of people will get care. Most people, the majority of people, have gone there because it's a great option for moving to in later life, especially if you know that when you need care, it's available from the on-site team that's there. So, and because this is not somewhere where everybody gets care, it's not somewhere that is defined by dependency. And people there that get care get it in an environment where most people don't, just like the world at large. And as it said on the film, there is not a care wing. As you walk around the village of 250 apartments, you can't tell as you go past someone's door whether they buy or whether they rent, and you can't tell whether they get care or not, because every single apartment is pretty much the same inside, and every single one is able to cope with somebody with quite a high degree of care. Big stress in our developments on activities and volunteering, because whether it's brain activity or physical activity or social activity, it's the chance of meeting people which is really important. Phil talked about loneliness earlier on, talked about isolation. You don't have to be lonely in one of our villages. Because of the sales model we have, we're able to provide these with very low levels of capital grant from the government, or in many cases, no grant at all. All it means is that you have to have more sales compared with rent. But as a charity, we will always have at least 20% of the people renting. And that's what I mean by the sales cross subsidy. It's selling, and it's getting people to tap into that £1 trillion worth of equity that we heard about earlier, that is the model that works for us, and which I think could be scaled up to work for many more people. There's a list there of the typical facilities you would find in a village. Did you see the guy in the woodwork shop on the film who was using that buzzsaw going along? There's all kinds of ways in those woodwork rooms where you can cut bits off yourself if you're not careful. But it's one good example, I think, of saying, well, if you turn a health and safety officer loose on some of our villages, that they will have a fit with some of the things that go on. But it's very important that people are still pushing the boundaries in a reasonably safe way, and that we don't get to the point that says if you're 65, 70, 75, all that sort of dangerous activity stops. We used to show a video of somebody well into their 90s doing a skydive, just to sort of illustrate that point. And we had to say it wasn't compulsory for anybody who was thinking of living in the village later on. But it's these sorts of things and letting people carry on the activities, which are really just a means of bringing people together. It's not so important that you're knitting or you're stitching or you're doing pottery or you're making things out of wood or that you're dancing or doing Pilates or whatever it is. It's the fact that you're doing it with people and you've therefore got an opportunity to interact that isn't available to most people who live outside these sorts of places. The fact that we've got the wellbeing centre there and a wellbeing nurse based in every single village means that all the residents, not those on care, but all the residents have got access to some good preventative healthcare information. And we do find that people are much more likely to go along and have a word with somebody they tend to regard as a friend rather than book in at the surgery, which has meant that we've been able to have early identification of things like osteoporosis and diabetes and some of the things which will affect people of a certain age. And the film talked about the work that we're doing with people for early stage dementia as well. That's the second village in Milton Keynes. The one that you went to, Lovett Fields, is on the east side of Milton Keynes. If you go right the way through the city on the far side, you get to the Shenley area of Milton Keynes, and this one opened last year. Total of 300 apartments in two phases. More than 200 of those apartments are either for outright sale or shared ownership sale. And every single one of those apartments in two phases last year was reserved by somebody before the builders handed it over. There is absolutely no problem at all in selling these. There is a huge pent-up demand in this country from older people to be able to buy into something which reflects the lifestyle they want to have. And very few people are doing it, certainly doing it in the market that we are in. That's one that's going to open later on this year. That's on the west side of Birmingham at Hagley Road. Anybody who knows Birmingham would have driven past the hoardings on that site over the past couple of years and seen something very big taking place there. And that's going to be our third village in Birmingham. I've got to say that the Birmingham City Council really gets the concept of the retirement village and wanted us to do five. They went up and saw the one we got in Warrington and decided they wanted five like that. And spread all around the city for some very different demographics. That's also in Birmingham, that opened last year. That's in the Newtown Lascelles area of Birmingham. Anybody who knows Birmingham knows that that isn't the most deprived ward in the country. But there's only 13 that are more deprived and something like many, many thousands which are less deprived. It's an area which is predominantly a black and minority ethnic population, and panel court represents that. And so, you know, the point that I'm making is that this particular model is adaptable culturally. And we have had to learn a lot about diet, and we've had to learn a lot about particular health issues, depending on the population that we're working with. But essentially, it is the same model. And I'll make the point again, this is not retirement living in the leafy home counties. This is retirement living which can take place in all the cities in the country. And it's a model that doesn't have to be particularly expensive to the Treasury in either capital or revenue terms. And it's a model that's very popular and that people like. We know that when people live in our retirement villages, they are generally, as a group, they're going to live longer, they're going to live more happily, and they're going to be more healthy than any cohort of the population that's either outside in the community or which has moved into residential care at about the same sort of time. I like to think it's the antidote to loneliness, because you get the same sort of brush-by contact opportunities in one of these villages that most of us take for granted, but which actually aren't available to the population at large of a certain age who are doing what most people say they want to do, which is staying in their own home. Just think about it. If you're staying in your own home, you're in your bungalow, you're in your house, there's just you, you had a partner, maybe you don't have a partner anymore. Your children aren't going to be around 7 days a week. Life isn't like that. You may have friends, you may not have friends that are available. But if you want company, what can you do? Would you go and sit in Starbucks on the off chance that somebody might strike up a conversation with you in a safe way? Or the park? Or the pub? The great thing about these is you can go and have a coffee somewhere and people will walk by that you know, pretty much that you know. And therefore, the chance for doing something and interacting and not having to be lonely is there. And I've mentioned before that these are very popular. There is a very, very high demand from people to buy these. I'll come on to some international contacts in a moment because I think there is an important point here that we're not on our own. But when I was speaking in Australia last year about what we do and how we do it, someone said to me, but Nick, why would people buy in a development of yours where they might be living next door to somebody who's renting? they thought it was completely counterintuitive. And I said, well, actually those boundaries tend to disappear. It's less important what your tenure is. But I said, the other thing is that if they weren't buying from us in that sort of environment, then these people wouldn't be buying at all. Because when we build a retirement village in Nottingham, where the average house price in the area where we built it is about, £150,000, people can't cash that house and buy into retirement living of the sort that the private operators will develop. So there's a niche market here waiting to be exploited. And I really don't mind. I'm waiting for other people to come along and do what we do. But at the moment, they're really not. Unlike the United States, Australia, etc., etc., etc. The stats on this are quite interesting. Something like 15% of people over 65 in the United States are living in housing that was purpose-built for older people. It's something like 7% or thereabouts in Australia or New Zealand. In this country, it's not even 1%. Not even 1%. And I'm not talking here about our villages. I'm not talking about all extra care housing. I'm talking about all retirement housing, the local authority sheltered housing, McCarthy and Stone's product, etc., etc. There really isn't very much of it in this country. And that is a huge break on people's aspirations in later life. Because as somebody put it to me in Coventry, where we're going to start a new village this year, they said, this is great. When are you coming? Why can't you do it quicker? Because we're in a 5-bedroom house in the Earlston area of Coventry. And frankly, what would we give it up for? We'd only give it up for something we really want to go to. So, you know, we've produced the stats on this over a long period of time now to show that the people moving into our villages are leaving behind family housing, both in the private sector, which is a stimulus to the local economy, and for people coming off local authority and housing association properties, then that's releasing family housing back into the public sector. So when we talk sometimes to local authority, I say about, you know, us maybe doing a village in their area, and they say, no, actually what we want in this area is more family housing. And we say, yes, but if you build one of these, if you help us to build one of these, you can get some of that family housing back, but some get it, some don't. The theme of today has been about integrating housing, health and social care successfully. And my submission is that we're able to do that. A couple of slides to finish with, particularly on care. We provide care on site with our own people. So these aren't developments where we operate the housing and another care provider comes in. We think it's really important that it's us that's doing that, and it's all part of our own team. And of course, we, like everybody else, is regulated by the Care Quality Commission. We're regulated to provide personal care in each of these developments, and we're also regulated for diagnostic work as well. One of the features that you'll pick up on here is that if you're an owner in one of our apartments, you may have sunk all of your money into buying that home. And if you've done that, then the odds are that you might have reduced your capital down below the £23,000 limit, which means that you can then get help towards your care costs, because you're getting care in your own home, so that they cannot take into account the value of your own home in assessing your assets in order to decide how much the government will pay towards that. So the money is protected once you've bought into this. And increasingly, we are operating our teams not just for the people that live in the villages, but as a domiciliary care service for the surrounding neighbourhoods as well. That helps to give us the economies of scale, which we need in a day when local authorities don't hand out block contracts in the way that they used to, sadly. But it also means that we are starting to introduce people nearby into what life is like in the village, because there's a sort of come in, use the gymnasium, use some of the other facilities. There's that aspect to it, as well as making the village much more a part of the local neighbourhood than perhaps it was before. I've talked about this in other places on the theme of apartments for life, which is not a phrase that's used that much here, but it is used increasingly abroad. And my answer to that is usually, this is an apartment for life for somebody, usually. We can cope with just about any sort of physical disability that someone has, just about, provided that either they, or more particularly somebody on their behalf, is going to be able to pay the care charges that go with that. And one of the huge frustrations we have, and I know some of our residents have, is when we know that we could cope for them, and we know that we could provide end-of-life care if it is coming to that. But actually the person who's paying the bills, the local authority or whoever, is saying, well, now that it's gone to more than 30 or 35 hours a week, actually we want the person out of there and receiving care somewhere else. And I do hope that the government's white paper last year is serious when it talks about people having more choice about where care is delivered, because most people would want to stay amongst the people that they know in the community. The area we would struggle with is when dementia becomes to the point where it's difficult for the person and for their neighbours, for that person to sustain in our environment. Because we don't have a separate locked corridor or a separate locked area or somewhere which is particularly for people with severe dementia, because we have everybody mixed up in their own homes around the community, there can be instances where somebody can't stay there any longer. And at that point, we have to have the conversation about where's going to be more appropriate. The question mark, who pays the bill, is a reference to Dil Noughton and the talk about the cap and how care is paid for and where that's going to go. And our one of our contributions towards that is that at our newest villages in Milton Keynes and Birmingham, we are now selling our own product that we call Care for Life. And in very, very simple terms, if somebody comes to us and doesn't have a care need at the moment, then we will tell them that if they would hand over to us at that stage, maybe £50,000, something like that, we would guarantee to provide them with care when they need it for as long as they need it. And at the point that we can't provide it anymore, we'll give them a £600 a week voucher to take to somebody else that can help provide that. Now, that's us running our own insurance scheme, if you like. And we're confident that we can do it. We've looked at the figures of people in our villages over an 8, 9, 10 year period. And we know amongst the cohort of people we deal with, we can take that risk and offer that to people and give them that certainty of care into the future. So, you know, residents moving into our properties don't have to wait until the government's proposals kick in 2017, 18 or whenever it is. And they don't have to worry at that stage about where the care might be provided by the government at that stage. They know it can be provided by us and carry on in their own home. Now, I've deliberately sort of rushed through that a bit and left about 10 minutes for people to pick me up and tell me that it can't be as good as all that. And I must have missed out some of the tricky bits. So this is your opportunity to pick me up on all of that. Just before I open that up to the floor, there are these little green booklets which tell you a bit more about us, show you where all of our developments are now, show you where the next six are that we're going to build around the country, Birmingham, High Wycombe, Coventry, and just outside Bristol. And do pick one of these up. There's just about enough for everybody that's in the room at the moment.